This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Plowshares into swords. Weaponized Knowledge, Liberal Order, and the League of Nations. By David Ekbladh. Published by the University of Chicago Press. Introduction, Knowledge in Exile. Do you know the answers? Quoted from promotional materials, World Economic Survey, 1935. Dunkirk of an Idea. On August 21, 1940, visitors enjoying the final days of the New York World's Fair could have glanced into the summer sky and seen an agent of global interconnection at work. Cast in that role was the Pan-American Yankee Clipper, which had captured public imagination by demonstrating the potential of the airplane's ability to shrink distance. Its flight that day was actually a transplant operation, moving strategic materials from a fascist-dominated Europe to the United States. When the aircraft touched down at the Marine Air Terminal, now part of LaGuardia Airport, in Queens, New York, just a few miles from the fair, officials who had conspired for its escape greeted it with enthusiastic relief. Once on the ground, the consignment, the vanguard of a larger shipment that would make its way to the United States by sea via Lisbon, was shuttled past the waiting press. A large car provided by the president of the Institute of Advanced Study, IAS, whisked the cargo away to that refuge in Princeton, New Jersey. That cargo was knowledge. The arrival itself was an end to an odyssey of disaster, perfidy, mishap, and hope. This chain of events was later called an ideological Dunkirk. The journey was another near escape in the general rout of liberal forces in 1940. In a moment of geopolitical upheaval, with the fall of France and the apparent triumph of fascism in continental Europe, a great effort had been made to save something valuable, knowledge. The Clipper brought key figures and reams of data from the League of Nations Economic and Financial Section to the United States, where they would stay for the duration of World War II. What had been saved were information and the capability to analyze it, cultivated by the League of Nations over the preceding decade. The rescue demonstrated how the League, once the center of hope for a reformed and peaceful world, had itself had been reduced to a refugee, exiled from events that had long slipped out of its control. Irony was hard to avoid, considering that the League found asylum in a country that had officially turned its back on it two decades before. Unfolding disaster in Europe that threatened the League's very existence had inspired a sudden shift. The League would live on in the United States. Why? The United States had never officially been a member of the League. What was it that motivated important American institutions and individuals to invest in the support and rescue of one segment of an organization that had never been uniformly popular or politically palatable? The answer was exemplified by the material that disembarked from the Clipper. This is a story about how information and the knowledge it fosters were used by the United States and others as a crucial currency in world affairs. To govern and defend a modern global order, the United States sought to build a steady stream of information about economics, politics, and other aspects of human experience. It is striking how many institutions and individuals leaned on the League for information, and, equally important, contributed to the processing of the very raw material they had gathered from Geneva. The story behind the Clipper's flight is critical for understanding a larger story regarding liberal order. The League mattered because it was part of a larger group of advocates, a liberal international society that included the United States. This perspective cuts against the conventional narrative of a set of Wilsonians who looked to the League as a sort of holy grail, as a means to achieve a global condominium through adjudication and collective security. The debate over whether the League's political mission could have succeeded, were the United States to have joined it, has gone on in circles since the League's founding. Speculation on what U.S. membership in the League would have meant has occluded the significance of the United States' cooperation with the League in the pursuit of data and construction of knowledge. What remains interesting, and largely unexplored, is not that those Americans who cooperated with the League's project of information gathering and analysis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.